Hi, my name is Paul Thiemann, and I'm a professor at the Rochester Institute of Technology in Rochester, New York. And what I want to do today is talk to you about how data is represented internally in a computer. Some of this will probably be a review, which I think is probably a good thing, and hopefully some of it will be new and you'll learn something interesting along the way. So the first thing I thought I would do is just kind of start with some simple stuff that I'm sure you've seen before, but I want to make sure we're all on the same page before we get too far into this. And what I want to just do is go over converting binary numbers to decimal and decimal numbers to binary. So let's take looking at a binary number to decimal first, okay? As you probably learned in class, we use numbering systems that are referred to as positional numbering systems. And the reason we call them positional numbering systems is because each position in the number represents a particular power of the base of the number that we're representing here. So in binary, each one of the binary digits or bits represents a different power of two. So what we need to do if we want to convert a binary number from binary to decimal, what we basically need to do is figure out what powers of two we need to add together. And adding those powers together will tell us what the number is. Now, the way I typically do this is I'll draw myself a little chart and I'll put the binary number in the chart. So you'll see here in the top row, I've got the number that I want to convert. And in the bottom, it's blank at the moment. And now what I'll do is I'll just simply fill in the powers of two that each one of those bits represents, okay? So starting over at the right-hand side, we start with one. You're always gonna start with one regardless of the base you're working in, because any number raised to zero is gonna be one. And then since I'm working in binary, as I work my way from right to left, what I just simply do is multiply by two. So you see it's 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, so on up to 512, okay? So that's the start. Now, the nice thing about converting a binary number to decimal is when we look at the binary digits, there's only two possibilities. There's either gonna be a one or a zero. And the nice thing is if the bit is a zero, it means that the power is not in the sum. So what I will also do in my little chart typically is I will just simply cross out any of the values where the bits are a zero, okay? And in this particular case, that leaves the powers of two, 512, 256, 32, 8, and 2. And what I do is I add those together and I get 810. So I know that the binary number 11001010 is equivalent to the decimal number 810. Now, another thing that I always like to do is kind of have a way of checking myself to make sure that I did things right. And there's a simple little check that you can do in these binary conversions just to kind of make sure that things are, you know, at least you got something close to the right answer. And what that has to do with is basically that power of two to the zero, okay? If you take a look at all the powers of two with the exception of two to the zero, which is one, they're all even. Which means if I am representing an odd number in binary, that bottom bit or the least significant bit has to be set to a one. So I can look at that binary number 11001010 without even converting it, because it ends in zero, I know it's an even number. And so what I always do is kind of a self-check is I make a double check and I say to myself, since my binary number ends in zero, the decimal value that I get as a result of the conversion must be even as well, okay? If it's not, if I get an odd decimal value, then I know I did something wrong and I'll go back and check my work, okay? So that's converting binary to decimal. And I find that really simple to do, okay? Now let's take the flip side. You're given a number in decimal and you have to convert that to binary, all right? Again, I'm gonna start it out basically the same way. I'm gonna do my little table and I wanna figure out what powers are going to be powers of two I need to add together here to get 453. So what I've done, you'll see in this case, is I've filled the powers in the bottom row and I've left the top row blank because I need to figure out whether the corresponding bit for each one of those columns is either a zero or a one. The other thing that I want you to kind of notice, and hopefully you spotted it right off the top of your head, 453 is an odd number. So I know whatever answer I get here, that least significant bit where we have 2 to the 0, it has to be a 1. And if it's not, I did something wrong when I did the conversion. Now, another question that you might want to ask yourself is, how do I know how many powers of 2, how many columns I'm going to put in this table, all right? Remember, what I'm trying to do here is I want to figure out the powers of 2 that I need to add together to get the number 453. If I have a power of 2 that's greater than 453, like 512, 512 can't possibly be one of the numbers that I need to add together to get 453. So what I'll do when I'm generating my table is I'll happily double my numbers until I hit the first power of 2 that's greater than the number that I'm trying to convert. So that's why I stopped at 512 here, okay? And the next thing I'll do is I'll pop a 0 in that column just to remind myself that power is not going to be in this number, all right? So now the question is, how do I do the conversion? Well, the way I use the table and the way that I do the conversion here is I'll work my way in this particular case from left to right. And for each power, I'll ask the question, can I subtract that power from the number I'm trying to convert? So I have 256, 256 is less than 453. So I know that the power 256 has to be in the binary number that's going to be the equivalent of 453. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a 1 above 256 as a reminder that that's going to be in the resulting binary number. And then the other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take 453, I'm going to subtract 256 from it because I've accounted for that number already. That leaves me with 197. And so now as I work my way down the table and I consider the next column, I'm going to be looking at 197 and not 453. Okay. And as I work my way across, I look at 128. 128 is less than 197. So I'll put a 1 up there. And as I did before, I'll compute what the difference is. Working my way down the line, I see that 64 is less than 69. So again, I'll put a 1 up there. Okay. And now I only have 5 left. The next column is the column that represents 32. Well, that can't be in it. It's too big. 16 can't be in it because it's too big. 8 can't be in it because it's too big. That gets me down to 4. Well, 4 is going to be in that. So I'll take put a 1 above the 4 as a reminder that that's it. That bit is turned on in this particular binary representation. I'll subtract 4 from 5. I have a 1 left. 2 is bigger than 1, so there'll be a 0 there. And lo and behold, I have 1 left, so I'm going to put a 1 above, and I've accounted for all the numbers. And so reading the binary number off the table, I can see that 453 decimal is equivalent to 11100101 in binary. And again, what I want you to notice is we spotted up front ahead of time that 453 is an odd number. So is 11100101 because it ends in a 1. Okay, so there's a little bit of confidence that we got it right. Now, the other thing that I want to, again, just go over real quick, and again, I think this is a review, but this is going to be very pertinent to what I'm going to show you in a minute, is I want to ask the question, if I have a certain number of bits that I'm going to use to represent a number, what's the range of numbers that I can represent in that number of bits? Okay, and what I did here, just so that we have a kind of a concrete point, is how many unique values can I represent in an 8-bit number? But you should be able to answer this question really for binary numbers that have an arbitrary, you know, any number of bits. Okay, so how can we figure this out? Well, a lot of times what I like to do is I like to kind of try to walk very slowly to get to the solution. So what I'll ask myself first here is, well, what if I only have 1 bit? How many unique values can I represent using 1 bit? Well, with 1 bit, I can either represent 0 or I can represent 1. And what that means is I have 2 values, okay? What if I jump up to 2 bits now? Well, if I jump up to 2 bits, you can see I now have 4 values, all right? And if you take a look at that table, you'll kind of notice a pattern. If you look in the right-hand column, you're going to notice it goes 0101, which is exactly the one bit pattern, but it's duplicated twice. And then if you look at the column on the left-hand side, you're going to see that I put a zero in front of the first repetition from that two-bit, from that one-bit table, and then a one in front of it, and that's how you get four, right? What about three bits? Okay, well, here's three bits, and again, with three bits, you can see that it's going to be eight unique values. And again, the same pattern applies. So doing this, it sort of looks like we could say, well, it looks like if you take two, raise it to the number of bits that you have, that's going to give you the number of values. At least it applies for these three cases here. So let's try that out. Okay, let's try it for four bits. According to that postulation we made on the previous slide, this should be, we should be able to represent 16 values using four bits, all right? Well, with four bits, the largest number that I can represent in binary is 1111. And if you do a quick conversion in your head, you'll realize that that's 15 decimal, okay? So what that means is in four bits, I can count 1, 2, 3, da, 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 up to 15 using four bits. But you might look at that and say, but that's only 15 values. So that seems to break the rule that you came up with on the previous slide. But we left out something really important. And this is something that comes up over and over and over again in computing. You've got to remember that zero is also a value that we can represent. So when we look at counting, I actually start counting at zero. And if I start counting at zero and if I go up to 15, while the maximum value that I can represent is 15, there are actually 16 unique values there. So it does work. So in general, what we can say is you take the number of bits, you raise two to that. So using 8 bits to answer the question we had on that very first slide, using 8 bits, I can represent a total of 256 different values. For n bits, I can represent 2^n different values. Okay, so like I said, that should just be a review. I think it's something that you've probably seen before. You may have done it a little bit differently, but sometimes looking at something from different perspectives gives you a little bit more insight into it, okay? The big thing I want you to remember from this presentation is that if something is in the computer, it's nothing but bits. And I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's numbers that we just looked at, images, videos. This presentation you're looking at is inside a computer. It's nothing but bits, all right? Just a crazy stream of zeros and ones. That's everything that's inside that universe of the computer. Now, at first you might think that that's rather limiting, but it's actually kind of empowering because if we have things that are represented in bits and they're in the computer, something that a computer is really good at is manipulating bits. So once it's in digital form, once it's in the computer, once it's represented as a stream of zeros and ones, it can be very easily manipulated by a program. And that's basically what I want to talk about next. So before I get into that, again, a quick review. I'm going to do some image stuff here, and I want to remind you how images work inside a computer. The first thing we need to do is delve a little bit into color science. And there's a variety of different models that color scientists use to understand and represent and model colors. One that is commonly used in computing is a model that's called RGB, where R stands for red, G stands for green, and B stands for blue. And it's an additive color model where you create colors by adding together different intensities of those three basic colors. And that little diagram that I have on the right there, that it basically looks like a Venn diagram, is showing you very simply, if I don't vary the intensity of the RGB components, you can see that using those three different colors, it's actually possible to represent a total of seven different colors. You can see the red, the green, and the blue, and then you can see the yellow, the purple, and whatever color that is with the G and the B, plus white in the middle, okay? And I guess theoretically, you could say there's an eighth color in there, which is good for computers because we love powers of two. The black is also a color that's represented there as well, Okay. So how do we represent images inside a computer? Well, this is a picture of my very first cat. His name is Grumpy Cat. And Grumpy Cat was called Grumpy Cat because he was a little bit strange. He would always want to get petted. But as soon as you petted him, he would bite you. And it wasn't like a love bite. It was like, I'm drawing blood. So that's why we called him Grumpy. So this is obviously a picture of Grumpy. He's obviously in the computer, or not him, but the images. And the question is, well, how do we represent this as a stream of bits? Well, commonly, a very common way of representing an image is we'll take an image and we'll divide it up into a number of different cells. All right. So what I've done here is I've laid a grid over the picture of Grumpy. All right. Basically, this is being done at a much finer scale in this image. In fact, the scale of these squares is so small that your eyes can't discern them. All right. And that's kind of the magic here. Each one of those individual cells is referred to as a pixel, and each pixel has one unique color associated with it. And that color is based on an R, a G, and a B value, all right? Now, it's a little bit hard to see the granularity here. So what I did is I took just Grumpy's eye and I blew it up at 800%. And now you can actually start to see the pixels that make up his eye, okay? And if you look carefully, you'll see that each one of those pixels has its own color associated with it, all right? And that's basically how images are represented inside a computer. And again, I expect it's a bit of a review. One thing that I want to just note is that there are many different schemes that you can use to do the RGB, the RGB model. Namely, one of the things that you can differ is the number of bits. What I'm going to do here is assume that we're using 8 bits for each of those color channels. So we have 8 bits for red, 8 bits for green, and 8 bits for blue. And using 8 bits for those three colors, we can represent more than 16 million different colors. Okay, all right. Now, what I wanted to do is talk about a technique called steganography. And steganography, it sounds really complicated, but it's something that's been around forever. And it's the practice of hiding a message within another message or within another physical object, okay? And if you take a look at that second sentence there, Laura's spending echoed assorted priorities for accurate skateboard use. You might kind of look at that and say, that's a little bit of a weird sentence, but I guess then it makes sense. But what I've actually done is I've embedded a message inside of that. And until I tell you how to decode that message, you don't know what it is. But I will tell you, if you look at the second letter in each of the words in that sentence, it will give you a hidden message. So if I, what I did here is I just bolded them, and maybe you can see it now, and it's still a little bit noisy, but if I just pull those out, you'll see that the message is APCS rocks. That's steganography. It's been around forever. And there's lots of classic examples of it. If this is something of interest to you, I strongly encourage you at some point, Google steganography sometime and find out about it. So why am I bringing this up? Well, what I'm wondering is, can we hide a message inside of a digital picture? The answer is going to be yes. And so the question is, how could I go about doing that? All right. Well, if I want to hide a message inside a digital picture, what I'm going to have to do is modify some of the bits in that picture to encode the message, all right? Kind of like what I did in that previous sentence. It was a pain to come up with. I had to come up with words that had the right second letter in it, all right? And I need to kind of do the same thing here. I need to change some of the bits in the picture. Now, I've already mentioned that in an 8-bit RGB image, we can, in one pixel, I can represent 16 million different colors. So a question might be is, do we really need all 24 of those bits? At what point is it kind of overkill? Either our eyes can't tell the difference, you know, can our eyes finally determine the difference between more than 16 million different colors? I know mine certainly cannot. And another question is, well, what about the resolution of the device that I'm displaying the image on. A typical computer or a cell phone, the resolution is probably not going to be that good anyway. So even though we have 16 million different color possibilities, the display itself may not actually be able to show them. So the question that I kind of want to ask is, if I take a picture and if I start mucking around with some of the bits in the picture, at what point do I notice it? So this is a picture of me when I was in New Zealand, and I thought I'd stop at, this happens to be Samwise Gamgee's house from The Hobbit. I'm checking to see if anybody's home, all right? And this is the original picture that I took with my cell phone. The basic model that you're seeing here is exactly what I described, all right? There's 24 bits here that are being used for each pixel. And what I did here is I wrote a program that took this picture and went through all the pixel values and turned off the least significant bit. So what I did here, and that's what I'm trying to say at the top, is the first 7 bits in every one of those color channels, I left them alone, but I turned the last one off. So now, instead of using 24 bits to represent the color, I've cut it down to 21 bits. And using 21 bits, I can still represent a little bit more than 2 million colors. And I'm going to flip back and forth here for a minute, but it's pretty hard to tell that I did anything to that picture. Well, what about turning off another bit? All right, so here I've turned off the last 2 bits. And so now I'm down to 18 bits. I have a possibility of 262 different colors now. All right, but again, I think as I go back and forth, you're gonna see, at least I don't notice much of a difference. Here I've turned off the last 3 bits, so now I'm down to 32,000 colors, all right? And let's go one step further, let's go to 4. And now I've turned off the bottom 4 bits, so now you have 496 different colors that I use. And I think you can finally, at least I can see it for sure, you can start to see some differences in the picture. And the easiest place to spot them is look at the shadows on the Hobbit door. If you look, the shadow almost seems pixelated at this point. And it makes sense if you think about it, because I have fewer shades of that door color to work with. And so it's going to be harder for the image to make a smooth transition from the dark color to the light color, from the shadow to the light. Okay. And I think I went one step further to kind of push it out one little bit more. Here I've turned off all the bottom 5 bits. And now what you can see is the effect is really noticeable at this point. All right. I find it absolutely kind of remarkable that even after turning off 5 bits in each one of the color channels, in each one of the pixels in this picture, you can still see the image. It's really kind of remarkable, and it shows you how much extra information is actually encoded in those pictures. Okay, so let's get back to steganography now. So what can I do? Well, what I want to do is, we're computer people. So what I want to do is I want to encode my message, but I'm going to do it using ASCII. So here's an ASCII table, standard ASCII table. You've probably seen something like this before. Remember that ASCII is just the character mapping, and what it does is it maps characters to numbers. So if I want to represent, for example, a capital A in the computer, I do that with a decimal number 65, or if I were going to look at it in binary, it would be 01000001. So what I'm going to do is, the way that I'm going to encode my message is, I'm going to take just the least significant bit of the red channel of every single pixel to store 1 bit of an 8-bit ASCII character. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to take that 8-bit representation of the ASCII character, and I'm going to store it in 8 different pixels. The most significant will be in the first pixel, the next bit will be after that, and so on down the line, okay? The Hobbiton picture is 1,383 pixels high by 1945 wide. That means there's more than 2.5 million pixels in that image. which means if I'm going to use 8 of these for each ASCII character, I can store 350,000 characters in that message using this scheme. That's just using the red channel. I could also use the blue and the green channel if I wanted to. So what am I going to stick in there? Well, you can literally stick any text in there that you want, but what I thought I would do is pick something that you might recognize and something that has some heft to it. And what I did is I searched around online, and there's a website called Project Gutenberg. And Project Gutenberg's been around for a long, long time. And what they actually do is they were the first people that I'm aware of that had eBooks in a way. What they've done is they've taken many classic books and they've converted them to text form. So if you ever want to get the text from a book, it's got to be a classic book. Usually you'll find it on Project Gutenberg. So I went to Project Gutenberg and I got the entire text of the story Alice in Wonderland. Turns out there's 166,657 characters in that text. It'll easily fit in my picture. So how am I going to encode it? This is just a picture of what I was trying to describe before. I'm showing you the first 8 red values in my Hobbiton picture. And in the first 8, what I want to do is store the A, which we saw was 01000001. All right. And you can see what I've done. I'm going to put that most significant bit at the first RGB, the second bit in the next one, and so on down the line. And what I've done here is I've just shown you the A and the L. And if you look at the right-hand column, that's the modified value that I'm going to write out for that R value. And you're going to see that not all of these get changed. And that makes sense, because it's going to be the case that only about 50% of the time I'm going to need to actually change one of these bits, which means it's going to be even harder for you to observe a change in the image from embedding this message inside of it. And so, you know, long story short, this picture that you see here looks a lot like the very first picture that I showed you, but you'll just have to take my word for it that what I've done here is this particular picture actually has the entire story, Alice in Wonderland, encoded in the pixels in the picture. And in case you're curious, I needed about, when I take a look at the changes, out of all the changes that I made, I only changed about half of the pixels in the picture. And again, that just points out the fact that it's a little bit harder to for your eyes to see. So really the takeaway that I want you to see here is that A, once we have things in a binary form in the computer, we can do some pretty cool things with it. And B, and this is really an important thing that I'm sure you will discuss at some point in your CSP class, when you see an image on a computer, it may not necessarily be real. It is very easy to manipulate pictures and make them look like something totally different from what they actually are, okay? And then the last thing I thought I would leave you with is a joke. Well, sort of a joke, but this is a nerdy kind of a joke. There are 10 types of people in this world, those who understand binary and those who don't. So now that you're becoming a computer scientist, you can now appreciate what this shirt means. Okay, so with that, I hope you've enjoyed this presentation. I had fun putting it together, and I hope you learned something good from it. Have a great day. Thanks, bye.